I absolutely love showing off hidden gems here in Chandler. And I am with Mina Vukovic, who is the owner of Momentto Caffe, which has actually been a long-standing business, a family-owned business for a very long time, and right over here in sort of West Chandler.
Yes, yeah.
Let's just start, Mina. Thank you for having me today.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you for the wonderful coffee that we get to sample. Tell me let's just start by telling me a little bit about your business. You are a truly family-owned, generation-to-generation business.
Yes, we are. So we started here in 2001. We moved from Yugoslavia, from Montenegro. And then my dad built our whole production facility, the whole roasting plant, which is behind here. Mm-hmm. My grandpa used to roast in the garage, and my dad designed all of our equipment, and we brought that all here. So my mom makes all these pastries, mm-hmm. and my dad does all the roasting, and then everything is themed after my pup.
That is amazing. And when you say your dad made this, you mm-hmm. truly mean it. I was lucky mm-hmm. enough to get a little behind the scenes tour, yes. and there's a lot of custom made mm-hmm. materials back in
yes.
your warehouse.
Our roaster is custom made. Our packaging equipment is custom made. The roaster has 9 filtration systems. Mm-hmm. As I was telling you, our coffee goes from the farm to the bag here, meaning we only buy from family owned lots. Mm-hmm. So we're actually helping the people that we're buying the coffee from. And then over here.
And that's Central yes. America, you
yes,
said?
Yes, Central America. And then the one coffee that doesn't come from Central America is our decaf. It comes from Germany because it's Swiss water processed, meaning the coffee doesn't have formaldehyde in it. Mm-hmm. Because usually what makes it decaffeinated is they use formaldehyde to remove it, which is not healthy. It's not good.
Right.
So we get it from Germany because they use high pressure water to extract it, which is a caffeine that goes to Red Bull and Monster and all that. So it's actually pure.
And as a family-owned business, mm-hmm. was it important for you to support other families
Absolutely.
In their own business? Is that why you do it that way?
Yes, because we know how hard it is to make it as a family-owned business versus a corporation, mm-hmm. especially when you come here and you leave everything you know behind and you start from scratch. We know how important it is to support family businesses and local businesses, especially. So I want to give back to those that are also families on the other side helping. So we help each other.
That's amazing. One thing that you didn't mention, talking about the warehouse again mm-hmm. and your dad and what he mm-hmm. did, tell everyone about the roaster and yes. what's unique about that. I love it.
Our roaster roasts in its own drum, essentially. It doesn't, you know how when you go on Google, you see pictures of open roasters? Mm-hmm. Ours roasts in its own drum. So instead of everything being roasted at different, you know, temperatures, essentially, mm-hmm. some coffee being burnt, some being under roasted. Ours is roasted in unison, and we can roast 2 tons of coffee a day, and we save 35% of energy. We're completely green out of here. Because of how the roaster is built, it has two chimneys that recycle the air back and forth. So we only pull cold air once, and then while we're roasting, that air heats up. And it's free recycled once it's done with that roast and it comes back again. So it's hotter and hotter each roast. So we save energy without having to input air out and back. And we only let out vapor, no smoke. So mm-hmm. we don't put anything bad into the environment. It's all very eco-friendly.
Very sustainable.
Yes, very sustainable.
And custom. So it's all yes. proprietary to your business.
Exactly. And we also remove the chaffs, which mm-hmm. is the coffee skin, the outer layer of the bean. Because green beans are tiny when you roast them. They expand 2 to 3 times in size and shed their skin like a peanut. So we actually remove all of that. So with mm-hmm. us, you get a full pound of coffee versus 20 to 30% of the filler stuff, which are the chaffs.
Right.
So
I guess just to explain a little, you're a little mm-hmm. more than just the coffee shop,
yes,
the front that you
are.
See. What you were actually doing, you were more mm-hmm. distributing and
yes.
corporate clients.
Exactly. Wholesale, food distributors, private label. Mm-hmm. We specialize in all of that. We do custom bags with people's logos, custom
K-cups.
Yep. We do all of that stuff. So we're a one-stop shop, essentially. You get something from us. And we have a quick turnaround time. It's uh-huh. 14 days.
That's great.
So with us, you won't find us in stores for the fact that we want our coffee to be fresh. Anything you get from the grocery stores is at least 3 to 6 months old. Mm-hmm. So with us, it's actually a couple days old by the time you get it. So it has the quality, and I refuse to be in stores for the bare fact that I don't want you to have stale coffee when mm-hmm. you get it. It has a shelf life of a year, and I don't want to be in that business. I want people to have a nice access point here where they can come and get it and have the experience of a little European cafe, mm-hmm. you know, inside of Chandler, which is why my mom makes all the desserts, and it's like a home away from home here.
I wanted to talk about this part because this mm-hmm. is the customer-facing part where yes. everyone can see the actual cafe. And tell us a little about what you're trying to do yes. here. You have a couple of things that, you know, aren't typical with your coffee yes. shop. And one of them has four legs. So tell us what you're trying to create here first, and then let's talk about Jack.
Absolutely. So we are actually a no Wi-Fi, no laptop cafe mm-hmm. for the bare fact that we want you to come in here and get away from your everyday, because the way we think about
it. Because who doesn't want to do that right now?
Exactly. All I can think about is all we get in this life is time, right? And mm-hmm. I just want a single person to have a moment where their day gets better just by being in here, whether that's to relax or have a conversation with yes. a friend or come on a date or just sit down and have a second where they unplug from work. Mm-hmm. So that's why we do it. We don't mean to offend anyone or put anyone off, but we'd like it to be your little spot where you come in and relax.
And have a conversation.
Exactly.
Over a wonderful cup of coffee.
Exactly.
And a homemade dessert.
Mm-hmm. And the reason our coffees look like this is mm-hmm. we serve them traditionally. We have a macchiato here, an espresso here. Mm-hmm. And our menu is very much, you know, no Tirani syrups, none of that. Mm-hmm. We do all natural flavors because our coffee doesn't have bitterness or acidity. And so that way it's actually all natural and you don't get the calories, but you get the natural coffee
right.
and you have natural tastes in it. And it doesn't need sugar or anything of the sort.
That's amazing.
And I themed it all after my dog, Jax.
Well, which we can see, you know, on like right down to the place, yep. the little mats. They're
He's
so
a
cute.
Yeah.
So I would like to talk a little bit more about you specifically,
Absolutely.
Because I really like to highlight women who are doing interesting things. And you are a little different just because it is just that generation. Was there an expectation that this was going to be what you did?
Yes. Well, my dad always told me you're free to do whatever you like. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I saw
as long
dad,
as it says.
Yeah.
Just kidding.
I was going to actually be a cop. But then I realized I'm quite short. Uh-huh. And so I had to weigh a few things out with that. But my dad and mom worked so hard, and I didn't just want to hand this to someone else mm-hmm. and then have it be sold. I want this to be there when I have kids and things like that. So I started working with my dad from, I think I was 20.
Okay.
So then I built our online website. We didn't have a website. We didn't have a front walk-in store. We used to be off of Warner and Hardy, and you would walk in, and I gave up my office for a little like retail uh-huh. little coffee place, and people come in and I'd give them samples of coffee, and that's turned into creating thousands of customers mm-hmm. that now come in and have our coffee, buy it here, and come and enjoy it here.
So you have a long-standing mm-hmm. family business, started
yes.
with your grandpa, mm-hmm. your grandfather, and then you did what most children do. You took the business and
yes.
then brought it into that next level.
Yes.
How does that go? Being a family business has its own special
struggles.
Yep. Yeah, struggles and advantages.
It does, yes. And I mean, my dad and my mom are my best friends. So we get along, and every now and then you do butt heads, which my dad and his generation is like, oh, let's do it this way. I'm like, no, let's make it more efficient
mm-hmm.
because I can see so many things I can improve and change so we run smoother. That's with any technology I bring in, with any POS system, with
right.
anything like that. I try to make everything super smooth.
Mm-hmm.
And my parents were okay with me doing anything as long as I was happy. But my passion is here.
You found your heart here.
Yes, I love it. I mean, I love being able to spend time with my family all while also working. And we work very hard. Don't get me wrong. There's 5 of us here. And we have 14,000 square feet of pure equipment. And then we have all this. So we've made it so automated that one person can be on each piece of equipment and we can do 2 tons of coffee out of here a day just in roasting.
Wow.
That's not including packaging. So we have maximized everything.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, the challenges are just every single day, it's something else having your own business.
Right.
And I don't have one job task. I have 100 in one day. I'm our HR, I'm my payroll, I'm management, I'm planning, I'm logistics, I'm purchasing, I'm sales.
What would you say to somebody that was thinking about going into business with their family?
Be prepared. You know, be prepared for working very long
mm-hmm.
hours. Be prepared to pay yourself last.
Mm-hmm.
Be prepared for years where you may not make a cent.
But just know that hard work does pay off, and everyone's going to have different struggles with whatever business they go into. But as long as you can work through it and you stick by it, and you also don't take every single piece of advice to heart, you'll be good.
Was there any difficulties on having a business that's obviously been successful long before you came along, to go and feel like you wanted to put your own stamp on it, or any struggle there? It seems like your family's been very open, but there's always doing things a little differently.
Yes. So with my dad, we, you know, see eye to eye on most things. So we've decided things we don't see eye to eye on. Mm-hmm. He's just like, the coffee shop is yours. Do whatever you like, because we have different tastes with certain things. So the best way that we've learned to manage it is that each person does what they're good at, and the other person promises to stay out of it.
That's
otherwise
the way to make it happen.
Butt heads, and it just doesn't work. It's just like, I don't go in the back and tell my dad how to roast coffee. It's the same thing. Like, I know what works here, and we stick to that. Otherwise, I just don't feel like that works. You know, everyone has their strengths and weaknesses. And what we do here, too, is we always have our coffee. Jax is very excited. We always have our coffee every morning. We all talk. And when you go into packaging, it's a whole thing where everything's very fast moving. We want to make sure everyone's in the right mindset, best mood to go in there. You are working with industrial equipment, so you want to be as safe as possible, clear-headed. So we have our coffee in the morning. That's our time where we catch up and just talk, and our father and daughter. And then once we walk through those doors, then we're business partners.
Brilliant.
And then it's different.
Brilliant. All right. Well, is there anything else that you would like to add, or people should know about your business, or what it's like to run a business like this?
I mean, we love everything we do. Just if you're going to go into business, be prepared, like I said, for long hours, you know, paying yourself last, and all the hard work, some days that are going to break you and some days that are going to lift you up, but it is very, very worth it. And also lots of things that I've learned being a woman is sometimes you have to work twice as hard to get to different points or to earn respect. And I've learned that. So I've had to work twice as hard to gain respect of some people, especially because of my age.
That can
do
it.
And my gender. And so sometimes when I first started working with my dad, I wouldn't get taken seriously, or I would go into a room with a bunch of executives and they'd be like, so what's your espresso recipe? And I'd be like, oh, do you have $100,000 to give me? And then I'll give it to you. And they're like, smart girl.
Exactly.
But it takes a while to find your, how do you say it? Like, your strong foot forward and to put boundaries up and to say no, and to say, no, this doesn't work for me, or this does, or to kind of earn that respect. Because a lot of the time you realize it isn't just given, especially in business. You have to earn it.
Also, not only being a woman and fairly young when you're entering your profession, there's also that idea that it's a family and that you're only here, not because you're qualified, but because of your family.
Because my dad handed it to me, yes. So actually, and that's one good point, because I've had that happen. And the funny thing is, when I started working with my dad, I cleaned our bathrooms and I made boxes. I earned every single step. My dad didn't just hand me something. I had to earn it twice as hard as somebody else. I had to earn it so much harder, and my parents have never just handed me things. I've always had to earn them. So there's no, oh, this is yours because it's ours. No, if you're not going to perform and work, forget that. You have to actually invest that work into every single thing that you do, and then you're rewarded for it. But you don't just get to have this because you're my daughter. So that was always engraved into me. So I never grew up with this world mentality of, oh, whatever happens, I'll have this. No, it was either you're going to perform here and do your job and put the work in, or you don't get to have the business. You don't get to have that. So.
But you did grow up as an entrepreneur.
Yes.
And I think that shows in that sort of community that you've created here.
Thank you.
Right?
Yes. And I want it to be a safe space for everyone. Everyone's just come in, have a good time, ask us anything. We love people. We want you to get away from your everyday and just enjoy it here and enjoy your time.
Yes.
And just have a little spot to get away. I mean, we want it to be a community hub for every single person. Everyone is welcome here. So that's our goal, is to teach people about coffee, what's good coffee, what's bad, you know, educate everyone on it, have them have a place to enjoy, you know, our little slice of heaven.
Well, and speaking of teaching people about coffee, I have been promised that you'll teach me to make a little cup.
Absolutely.
So we're going to go do that. And we will also see you back in the studio. So I can't wait. Thank you.
Of course. Perfect.
This is wonderful.
So I'm going to teach you how to make the perfect shot of espresso.
Okay. Welcome back. I am so excited to introduce you to our next guest. She is fairly new to Chandler, but she is in a very important position. This is Monica Greenman, and your position is general manager of our Chandler Fashion Center, which you basically hold one of Chandler's hugest economic drivers right in your hands, right?
Right, right. So, we're excited.
Welcome.
Thank you so
and
much.
And thank you for being here, and thank you for choosing Chandler to come run, you know, the Chandler Fashion Center. Tell me a little bit, just big picture overview. Where'd you come from? What's your professional experience?
Okay. I'm a native of Arizona.
Awesome.
Born and raised in Phoenix, Good Samaritan Hospital, so right here. I wanted to be a psychologist.
Really?
Yeah, with a criminal justice background, a forensic psychologist.
Wow. So, okay, this is a big leap.
Yep. Went to school. NAU was my place. I was a lumberjack and thought, okay, I'll do this. Got out of college and was, you know, like everyone, poor and trying to find your first job.
Right.
And I was either going to pivot and go back to school or try the business world.
Okay.
And I did. I dropped into real estate by accident and loved it, loved it, loved it. I had a dear friend who had a beautiful Irish accent, and she was a receptionist at a development position.
Okay.
And they said, you're going to be the assistant property manager at this job, and we need a receptionist to fill your position. And she said, oh, well, come along. You're great. You're good with people. Just come and do this. So I was like, okay, sure, sure, why not?
You were young, out of college, just try stuff.
So when I got there, they said, well, we're going to pivot. We paid her more money to stay as a receptionist because she had this lovely Irish accent.
That people loved.
People loved. And you're going to be the assistant property manager. I was like, oh.
Wow, I just got a promotion, my first day on the job.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sounds fun. Didn't know what that was. And everyone I worked with, it was a development company in Washington State. And they were so kind and nice and let me do whatever I wanted to do. My boss at the time didn't mind not working so much. So he was like, sure, sure, give it to her, give it to her. And I was eager to learn the position. And you know when you drop into some things and you just love it?
Yes.
You absolutely love it. I found my heart. Like real estate was just, everything I did felt good. It wasn't going against the grain. And I just kept doing it. Making spreadsheets and making things intuitively that I didn't realize I could do. And they're like, yeah, that works. And I said, well, okay, just keep doing what you're doing. So I loved it, but I wanted to be back home. Mm-hmm. So I moved back to Arizona and still with real estate, stayed.
And commercial real estate, correct?
In commercial real estate. Okay. So it's all office buildings primarily. And loved it, worked my way up. Eventually had a couple kids, right? Did the whole checklist. I was of the age where you had a checklist, a dog, a fence, a house, a car. You just did what you're supposed to do.
Right.
So I was doing that, and I just kept rolling into things, Jane. It was so, I had this other position that was offered to me, and sure, it sounds great. Downtown Phoenix, a couple high rises, and they said, but we need a broker. Can you be our broker?
Oh, my goodness.
I know. That's what I said.
And I well, said, when you know when you're in the right position,
right.
When it feels right. And then when people keep offering you opportunities.
Yeah, it just came. And it just so happened that I had a free school. Somebody was opening a school in Gilbert, and they were offering free lessons. So I took them before I took the job.
Really?
And so I had all those classes done. Mm-hmm. I just had to take the test. So when I got offered this position, and they said, well, do you mind going to school for your broker's license? I go, you know, I went to school already. That's so weird that you say that. So it was so... it was like kismet. Mm-hmm. You know, it just all kind of happened. I wasn't looking for it. Got my broker's license. I was a broker for Heinz GS for a few years. And then just kept going. I was downtown Phoenix again, another high-rise Class A office building, Cityscape.
Right.
Loved it.
Which
loved
is beautiful. It, loved it. Cityscape is beautiful.
Beautiful. The whole court of retail as well. Mm-hmm. And the ice skating rink. Mm-hmm. That was my first exposure to the ice skating rink.
Been there. Love that
yeah.
thing.
The big Christmas tree. So I was having a great time. And then it just kept going. I needed more. Mm-hmm. I went back to school and got my MBA.
Excellent.
And again, it was friends of friends saying, well, you should do this, you know. And I'm like, well, everything's fine. But I
did. You just wanted a little bit more.
I did, yep. Mm-hmm. So once I got my MBA, I was just, you know, when you get stuck, everything you're doing is just like a clockwork, and you're like, mm-hmm. wait a minute. I need to use...
Things are fine.
Yes, everything is great.
But that little bell in your brain is going off.
It kept hitting. So I was introduced to some Maestridge folks.
Okay.
And they are just wonderful, intuitive, gentle, professional, smart people. Mm-hmm. And I just said, okay, I want to try that. That is great. So I made the leap from Class A office space to a mall, our... Chandler Fashion Center.
And just to clarify, Mace Rich is the overarching owner
yes.
of the Chandler Fashion Center.
Yes.
But it has only been a short time, just since this past April?
Correct.
So April. Just a few months.
But I definitely, they just said, okay, here you go. I had over $500,000 project to replace all the seating areas in the center, add electrical, add furniture, replace a tile. Just, you had to upscale everything. Mm-hmm. So they were making these massive changes. And I said, okay, I've done it before. I'm in. It's a center versus an office building. Mm-hmm. It's the same. It's assets. We can do this. So I had some fun doing that. And then right around the corner was Shields opening.
Right.
And
that's two huge things. Yeah. One, changing out all the assets. And then two, Shields is enormous.
It's a 250,000 square feet of monstrosous consumer goods. 600 fish in a 16,000 gallon aquarium. I mean, this is just off the top. Mm-hmm. So they have tons and tons of stuff there. It's beautiful.
And what's different, it's not like they were just moving in. They were completely reconstructing
yeah.
that entire property.
Nordstrom's was the previous owner or the previous occupant. Mm-hmm. They added about 20,000 square feet to that original building to create this. So this was, 3 years in the making. So I come along and I'm like, sure, I'll do this project. Sure, I'll be at the opening. I'm like, it wasn't me, but I just happened to be there to help unveil everything,
right.
which was so fortunate. I was so grateful.
Well, you know, my next question is about what steps your career path took, mm-hmm. but I don't think you really took steps. You sort of took leaps, hopping back and forth.
Yes.
What advice would you have based on kind of your career path? Because I'm imagining we said it a little earlier, probably when you were in high school or in college, you weren't thinking, I want to be general manager
right.
of a fashion center and
right.
do this.
You know, I think the best thing I've learned is to be true to myself.
Mm-hmm.
I absolutely loved real estate.
Mm-hmm.
I love figuring out, this sounds boring, but the taxes and the CAMs and just the look too. I wanted to make it pretty mm-hmm. and fun at the same time, which is unusual. I mean, in office buildings, you really don't do that. You make it professional.
Right.
In a mall, you have to make it attractive. You have to make it so people want to go there. From the smallest things, planters to trees to storefronts. All that is under what I do, which is phenomenal for me. So I'm living my dream right now. It's gorgeous.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
What would you say the biggest challenges in your position, and whether it's your current position or maybe just in the industry that you've worked in over the years?
You know, I think in my past, struggling, meeting with folks, whether it's a man or a woman, who just weren't very helpful.
Mm-hmm.
They just wanted to steamroll and, you know, I'm pretty small, I'm pretty petite, but I talk and I speak and I know what I want. And so that sometimes shocks folks
mm-hmm.
and not being that teamwork. So that's been my biggest struggle, is sometimes encountering folks who wanted to say, stay in your place.
Mm-hmm.
This is what you're supposed to be doing.
It's all my lane. You don't get to tell me to stay in my lane.
So over the years, I've learned, though, just to embrace that because
mm-hmm.
it's their own struggle they're figuring out. And I'm just happened to be here. So with that change of attitude that I've had over the years,
mm-hmm.
it's really affected me. It's helped them. It's helped me because they're not trying to hurt me. They're just having some struggles, and that's okay. But I need to go around. I need to figure it out.
That is fantastic
yeah.
advice.
Yes.
And as someone who is 5'2", I understand. I always just tell people I have a big personality.
Yes.
That's why you think I'm taller than that.
Exactly.
So
that, I think, was the biggest struggle. And I just continue to try and, you know, cure with love, cure
right.
with niceness, and see how I can help them.
Right.
Yeah.
So one thing, just to switch gears a little bit, we always like to talk about shopping local in Chandler. Mm-hmm. We want to keep those sales tax dollars here in Chandler. It's part of why we're so excited about Shields and the Chandler Fashion Center. But I think we need to look at it, too, at a broader perspective. Yeah. It's our small, locally owned businesses, which are incredibly important. Mm-hmm. But then it's also the larger organizations like the Chandler Fashion Center. So what are there things that you do to try and encourage businesses to come there? Are there challenges with maybe people shopping online and not actually coming to the businesses that are local here?
Yeah, I think as humans, we're still social. Mm-hmm. The brick and mortar is going to stay. We want to be out there. We want to touch things. We want to talk to people. I don't shop with my friends online. I meet them for coffee, meet them for a drink. We shop, we hang out, we talk. It's just a social thing too. The local versus national, I have it all. You go to Chandler Fashion and you have everything. You have our locals, you have our national brands. It depends on what you want. And there's always a group of folks that want something different. So that's what we want to be. We want to be that diversified place where you can get it all. We have, in fact, last weekend and this weekend, we're having pop-ups. A lot of the local brands, a lot of local shops are just doing pop-ups outside the food court. And they're selling, whether it's candles or their homemade jewelry. Oh. Or, you know, so we love that partnership. We embrace it. We want them to all be here because bottom line is the sales tax dollars all go back to Chandler. We go back to the schools, the police, the fire departments. So we give all that back. So that's kind of local. We keep it here.
So how do you sort of personalize that experience for people in such a big place?
You know, I think attention to details. I'm the girl looking at the elevator tracks. I'm the girl looking at the sign that's missing the letter. Like, come on. You know, I want the person that sits in the play area. If they notice my chairs are coming apart, I probably need new ones. So it's that little tiny details. I don't know what everybody wants, but I know what I want to see. And so I'm trying to keep on that same track and get our team to sit down. You know, if you have an event, sit at the event, look at it and see from your perspective sitting down, how does that look like? How does that feel? You know, if it feels too big and too crazy, we need to dial it in. Let's make people feel good when they come in here. We want to be the center. When you walk in, you're not lost. You know, if you can't find the restrooms, you can't find the store, we need a directional signage somewhere. We want people to feel like they're getting their hand held all the way through and walk them through there so they feel good about it.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
How do you do that with such a diverse array of businesses, too? You're working with very small businesses and very large corporations.
You know, that's an excellent question. International is a key. A lot of entrepreneurs that are not from this country. So second languages is, is another thing.
Didn't even think of that.
That's... Yeah. So we have a world, but it's just like the world. It's like when you meet people. People are still people. And boots on the ground here, that's who we have the relationship with. We do not, try not to make any ripples that go beyond the store. We're just trying to make it that comfort, that feeling, that vibe. So it's workable. It's just people. Excellent. And that's what I tell my team. If you're a house cleaner or you're an engineer and you see someone at the directory, ask them how you can help them. You can direct them. You can show them. It's that feeling that you need. So that's how we do it.
So the mall is a great discussion, but let's talk about you a little bit.
Okay.
So tell me if you're willing to share a little bit about your personal life.
Absolutely.
And like I said, we don't always like to talk about work-life balance because we know there is no such thing.
Yeah.
But if you want to talk a little bit about that, that'd be great too.
Okay. I've been
married. Have a busy plate for sure.
Yeah. It's fun though. See, it's busy when it's not, when it's hard. Mm-hmm. For me, it's fun. Everything is pivotal for what I do, what I like. So it's like second nature.
Right.
I've been married for 27 years. Just had my anniversary last week.
Congratulations.
Thank you. I have two sons, 17 and 20.
Okay.
And love them. Two boys, both in baseball or were in baseball. And we have fun. I mentioned I'm going on vacation this weekend or this week. We're going to take off somewhere. So I embrace it every day. Every day we have fun. We have dinner time. We talk. We chat. We go to baseball games. So we do lots of stuff together.
That's great.
A lot of family get together, a lot of gatherings. Mm-hmm. How the balance works is I know when to say no. I have to step away. I can't be on the computer at a baseball game. It's his time, his piece of the pie, and I focus on him. He knows he's important. Same with my husband. When we're out and we're doing something, we go to, you know, Saturday night, arcade night. Mm-hmm. We'll go play video games, the old 80s video games.
That's excellent.
Yeah, it's fun. But it's just something that we can do together, and it's still fun, and it reminds us of being young and kids again.
Uh-huh.
So I just think that kind of helps the balance, is still having fun
being
outside.
Being present in the moment.
Being present. That's really important for me.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
Well, I'm a boy mom too, so I love that. And on this show, we talk a lot about being a role model for women. Mm-hmm. Do you think, young women, do you think being a role model for your sons and being a role model for young men as a woman in business and in a leadership role is important too?
Absolutely. In my younger years, I thought so much. Like, I wanted to help women. I wanted to push them up. Mm-hmm. And later, I still do that, but it's people. Now it's humans. Mm-hmm. I want to push them up. I want to help them. They're struggling if they're doing something, and I know someone that can help them, I'll connect the two, connect the dots, you know. So that's what I'm trying to be more aware of now, mm-hmm. is that helping. It does ripple out. It's not helping me, it's helping them, and in turn, they're going to help somebody. And just sending that message, you have to do it. I mean, there's no other way.
Well, you know what? That leads us right into the next segment, mm-hmm. where we are going to get some questions from some of the young people from our Mayor's Youth Commission.
Okay.
And part of what we're trying to do is let some of our younger, and these are young women, actually ask questions of professionals that they might not be able to get in touch with or have those personal conversations. So that's coming up next, and really excited to hear what you have to say to these young people.
Okay. What is something you would tell your younger self based on something you know now?
What a great question. What would you tell your younger self based on what you know now?
I would tell myself to have more fun. And then when I get that feeling, that fire, that jive, that is what I should be doing, whatever that is. And I had that with real estate, and I should have known. It was definitely fun. Listen to me and embrace me. I used to wear long skirts and long shirts to cover myself because I didn't want to be seen.
Oh.
Again, I didn't know that back then. A friend told me this. She was like, Monica, you never embraced yourself until now. You just let everyone see you. You're okay. You're fun. Let people see you.
That is fantastic.
So I wish I would have done that sooner. You know, just said, this is who I am. You know, I like you. I'm nice. A person. I'm not mean. And let me help you. How can I help you?
I love that advice. We don't tell people to have fun often enough.
My team has heard all of it. If it's not fun and it's not pretty, we're not doing it. And they're like, I go, if what you're saying to me isn't fun and you can't make it look nice, we're not going to do it. And they're like, really? I'm like, absolutely.
Oh, you're living
absolutely.
It then.
Yes. So that would be it.
That's great.
Embrace it. Embrace yourself.
All right. Well, I'm looking forward to the next question then.
What are some valuable lessons you've learned throughout your career?
All right, that's another good question. What do you think?
You know, the one thing would say to speak up. I would be in a room full of men with suits, and they were so intimidating, mm-hmm. and I'd be the only female talking about construction or whatever development we're doing or management we're doing, and they would say some acronym, and I would just stay quiet. And I didn't know what they were talking about, and then I realized, you know what? If they can't talk normal with all of us and we don't know what they're talking about, then they shouldn't be speaking. And so I started raising my hand. What does the acronym mean? And some of them didn't know what it was. They've just been in the business so long, that's what they said.
Mm-hmm.
I said, well, no, we gotta know what that means. What's it mean? So we all understand what we're talking about. And so I started to kind of lead the group more and breaking down everyone's intimidation mm-hmm. of what was going on. And that's how we got nothing done. Because everybody was so scared about how they looked in front of these people that the project at hand wasn't moving. And I said, okay, no, we got to peel back this. What is our problem? What are we doing? And let's just be vulnerable together and let's fix it. Let's do it so no one sees.
If you aren't willing to admit you don't know something, how
right.
are you ever going to learn it?
Yeah. And that's been one of the things I've told people that have asked for help is you'll only look silly one time. And that's it. You'll know what that acronym is. You'll know what that word means. You'll write it down and you'll always know what that is. So
it's easier said than done.
It is. That first time you do it and you raise your hand and you speak up, they look at you like you have two heads and you say, well, I don't know. Can you help me? And
and that's okay.
They have to. They can't say, no, you silly girl, go outside. So that's been what I think.
Excellent. Yeah. That is great advice for our young people. Thank you so much for being here today.
I'm honored. I'm very grateful. Thank you.
And wishing you best of luck during the holiday season and as you continue on your journey at the Chandler Fashion Center. And I also want to thank our earlier guest, Mina, and her coffee shop for being such wonderful hosts to us. Remember to continue to choose Chandler and shop local, and have a wonderful day.